What's up, you beauties? Welcome to High and Wide Radio, episode 19 of season 6. I'm your host, Jim Icovone, joined by Jack Smith. If you're watching this live on YouTube, make sure you're subscribed and set an alert for future shows. And if you're listening as a podcast, please make sure you're listening and subscribed on Apple Podcasts or Spotify to get notifications for future episodes the minute we upload them. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, we have another topic-packed episode for you guys this week. It is the All-Star break. Unfortunately, or fortunately, there is some good news in the episode tonight. The Flyers sort of never fail to deliver, deliver on the drama. So, I mean, obviously, Jack, let's kick the show off, right, with Carter Hart. And obviously, we'll touch on the signings made last week. And Flyers are obviously on a 5-game skid heading into the break. We'll talk about how, you know, this news has affected them, the loss of Tippett, the loss of Carter Hart, and could things change, you know, for the end of the year? And we'll tie in some trade deadline discussion at some point in the show as well. I want to thank everybody for coming in, joining us. We have a good show on tap for you guys. So obviously the Carter Hart news came out. I mean, Jack, I said it on Twitter. We have a lot of faithful listeners, and we thank you guys. If you guys have been listening to us, I don't know, it feels like for at least the last year now, you kind of knew how we felt about this. We kind of were waiting for this day to come, right? It was one of the worst kept secrets in hockey, at least locally. I'm sure up in Canada as well. You know, we knew that he was going to be charged, and now we can say it, that Carter Hart has officially been charged. He was brought back to London, had to turn himself in on sexual assault charges by the London police in Ontario. And, you know, this thing is going to play out, Jack. You know, we can look at this from, we're a hockey podcast, so we'll look at it from the hockey perspective. We're not legal experts. You know, we don't know how things play out, especially in Canada. We're going to report information that's already out there, while also still trying to give our opinion. So, you know, if we slip up somewhere, there's a bunch of you in the comments. We depend on you guys to help keep us accountable. So don't be shy. So, Jack, obviously the news came out today. Like I said, we've been waiting for it. I mean, initial thoughts.
Like you said, worst kept secret. It feels kind of silly. And as you said, I'm going to keep this to hockey talk. all the trade scenarios we had discussed and talked about, how was it ever really realistic? Was it just a matter of time before this came out? Back of my mind, I'm going to say yes. One of the reasons I was open for trading Hart was because this was always looming. But seeing how it came down, it just felt like it was never going to happen. It was only a matter of time. Weird off season. Supposed to find this stuff out back in end of July, kind of never heard anything. So we just kind of let it go. What were we supposed to do? You know, it had already been, the case had already been closed once in 2019, I believe. And then, you know, obviously this time around, never got the information we were supposed to get. Hart starts the season. Flyers probably weren't even predicting that. And then it all comes back around and what have you. And here we are. And it's hard to speculate. You know what we know. We've heard what we've heard. But yeah, no, I mean, hang on one sec, Jim.
Special guest in the background. No worries. Yeah. So, real quick, I just want to, I'm sure everybody has seen by now, this is from Rick Westhead. He's retweeted the TSN, article from earlier today. So 4 NHLers have been named, just in case you guys maybe haven't heard by now. I'll repeat some of this stuff, to kind of fill in. Carter Hart, Michael McLeod, Dylan Dubé, and Cal Foote were the 4 NHLers named. Obviously, Alex Formenton is involved as well. They have been directed to surrender to the London police and be charged with sexual assault in connection with the alleged incident that occurred during a 2018 Hockey Canada event. Rick Westhead did repost here. And one thing I want to touch on, and we'll get to, this process may not play out for, I think I saw at least 2 years, and that's a long time, you know. We'll get to more of this, but I'll go ahead, Jack. I want to let you finish your point there. I'll leave it on a little cliffhanger.
I already 3 people have mentioned that was my dog in the background, which made me laugh. it just was never realistic that we were going to we were going to trade Hart. It's a shame because we like to speculate, and the idea of not getting the potential prospects or draft picks from such a trade, it really hurts. And I say that with obviously not having to lay out that, yes, the victim should get justice in this case, first and foremost. Just to reiterate, going to keep it to hockey here. So I will say, I've heard this before, and I hate to reiterate it, but it's so true. Thank God for Arison, because can you imagine what people be saying about how cursed the Flyers' goaltending is if we didn't have anybody in the pipeline, especially Arison here now, and Hart got yanked for this? Like, I mean, it would just be straight up depression.
It would be, yeah.
Team already, you know, trending downwards, which isn't necessarily the worst thing in the world. But thank God for Arison, that's for sure. And other prospects in the pipeline, including, I always say his name wrong. Is that, are you drinking? That's what I should be drinking.
That's coffee.
It's just espresso. Coffee. I thought, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Espresso. Yeah. There you go.
I need it.
But, I always have to look it up. Is it Kolosov?
Yeah, you got it.
Yeah, I didn't even have to look it up, baby. Something about his season could be ending. He could be potentially coming over sooner rather than later. I guess we're going to need him at this point. But hey, I officially have three dead jerseys. And I'm going to put them in. I may have said this before, but I'm going to have to put them in the corner. I got Voracek, Provorov, and now Carter Hart. And all three are just completely useless. And it's it is what it is. But
that's the life of a Flyers fan right there, man. I mean, I bought an official Richards jersey, I think, not long after he signed that contract. And I think a year later was when they traded him. Like, you buy the jersey as soon as they sign him to a long-term deal, right? And then even when he had the no trade clause in there, and they still found a way to move him.
Yeah, Jim's like, I got 3 days before it kicks in. I just got to hang in there. Yeah,
yeah, no, yeah, count down the days. Yeah.
I had a Bob, like, what do they call the a jersey, the t-shirt with the name or whatever or something like that. Yeah. They call it. Yeah, I got it like for Christmas, and that off season he was gone. I was like, okay, you know, it's like you said, it is what it is. It's all gonna come back around one of these days, and we're gonna be good again, you know. And his name is Michkov, so it's all that matters.
Yeah, for sure. So the Kolosov thing was interesting. You're right, because they signed him to an ELC not long after, I think, they drafted Michkov, and there was some uncertainty, and obviously the Carter Hart stuff came up again. Kolosov was signed to an ELC around that time. So, you know, we've been kind of piecing things together here. And so this is, I'll give you guys a clue on how I am, right? Because, like, we're not insiders. Like, we talk to a lot of people, yada, yada, but we piece things together just like everybody else. We can all play detective if we want. So there's been a chain of events that have been playing out right in front of us that shows you the Flyers were covering their ass when it came to the goaltender position, right? And so for someone like me, that I actually enjoy to connect dots and, you know, look into things too much. Jack, you know that about me by now. Sometimes, you know, I don't need to be looking, but I'm always looking. So once there's kind of smoke, I'm like, okay, well, now I got to go find proof that there's fire. And there was with this. I mentioned in this was not a secret. Like, this was the worst kept secret in hockey, especially Flyers hockey. Like, this day was coming for Hart. Unfortunately, you know, for the victim as well, first and foremost. But, you know, as Flyers fans, they drafted Hart. What was it? The second round, Jack. And we all thought, oh yeah, the savior. I thought, you know, I don't necessarily have favorite players anymore. Like, I don't have that sort of connection to any guy on the team. But I almost had that a little bit with Hart, and it was like, no, like, Arison can't replace Hart. This was maybe a year or so ago. And, once all of this stuff started to come out, and you can see what the Flyers were doing within the organization to, cover their butts when this day came, you know, the tie to Hart was kind of like, okay, well, you know, we have to brace for a future where Carter Hart is not the Flyers' number one goalie. And that became extremely apparent to me over the summer, this summer, Jack. Like, the clues were there that Carter Hart was not the guy. You know, it was a matter of, okay, well, the Flyers have to, you know, first of all, the Hockey Canada thing, but then it's like, okay, well, what are the Flyers going to do to kind of back up my thought there? And they signed Kolosov to the ELC. So you're right. The Russian season, I think, ends in February. So technically, he can come over here and play. I don't know if that'll be NHL or AHL, but he can, you know, play part of this season if he wants. And then what were the other parts there? They tried to trade Hart. They tried to trade him last summer. Like, those rumors were legit, right? And so if they were willing to do that in the summer, why would anything change? You know what I mean? I don't know. So factor in he's an RFA this summer. His contract's up. I'm on the side of I didn't think he was going to get paid, but he very well could have. Is that something the Flyers want to do? Especially knowing, you know, all this negative stuff kind of circling around. You factor in a guy like Keith Jones, you're not going to find a better guy in the NHL than Keith Jones, right? And I'm not sure what he's going to say or if he's going to say anything to touch on this, but as nice as he is, he's not the kind of guy that will accept something like this. Like, there is a line with Keith Jones. Does that make sense? Like, he's not one of those, what's the word? Don't mistake kindness for weakness. That's Keith Jones.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Right? He's no bullshit. He'll love you until you do something stupid. And they're trying to change their image and culture. And you can't have your starting goalie connected to this. And you absolutely can't extend this contract, give him a raise, you know, while this is happening. So for me, it was like, well, what's going to happen with Hart this summer? You know what I mean? They can't sign him until this stuff comes out. Now it comes out and you're finding out the legal process is a little longer up there. I think, as I mentioned, it could be 2 years till this is finished or even starts. Maybe, did you hear that, Jack? Was it start or finish?
What I did hear was everybody's getting tried individually, which will make it take that long.
That's the other thing.
I mean,
so Hart as a Flyer, Jack, is done for me. Yeah, like done. That, I don't see him ever putting on a Flyer sweater again or jersey, whatever you guys want to call it. And it's not because I'm saying he's guilty, right? I just think if you're trying to change your image, you can't have someone convicted, I'm sorry, charged even, associated with sexual assault, something like this. You just can't. There's going to have to be another team in the NHL that's going to have to be the one to give him a second chance. It's the Flyers are going to move on, right? Like, they're moving. They have the rebuild going. They don't have time to sit around and wait for Carter Hart to prove his innocence. Fortunately or unfortunately, I hope he is innocent for his own sake and, you know, the girl's sake. Don't get me wrong. It's just the timing is not right for the Flyers. They have to move on. That's my thought.
Yeah, I mean, it's typically how it happens too with other sports and other players. You don't typically see that player, unless you're thinking of like Odubel Herrera or whatnot. But like, if it's this, like a charge of this seriousness to this level, and he's going to be away for so long, he almost has to come back with another team. And just to clear up some of the questions I see in the chat about his contract, I believe he'll be put on administrative leave, and at some point the contract will either run out or be terminated. I even heard that Gary Bettman, if need be, does have the power to eliminate a contract. You know, I think there's a lot of ramifications around that. You can't just willy-nilly do that, but I think he has the power to do that. And I'm sure there's contract language and whatnot, how that could work out. So I think it alludes to what Briere said when asked about the situation. We will look for the league to guidance on that. And I think that's what's going to happen. And at the end of the day, everything points to between time, between the seriousness, you know, the odds of what we heard, if they're going to have a case like this. And I guess we'll find out a lot on February 5th, I think it is, streaming on Facebook. You know, they came, remember, all of them, including Hart, came out pretty hard saying that these accusations were false. He used the word false, and I forget, there was another word he used that just, they're sticking to their guns, that they did not do any wrongdoing, somebody else said in their statement. So we'll see what happens. Very rarely do I see these cases being just 100%, oh, it was, she lied or something like that. Like, very rare, you know, do you see that situation. So It's very, very hard. I mean, seeing him in the NHL in 2 or 3 years seems like a far cry, let alone with the Flyers. So I'm with you. I don't think he's a Flyer anymore. I don't think his career's over, but a lot's going to have to go right for him to get back on track. So we're just going to have to, you know, cut our losses. And you know what? Justice to the victim. And,
right,
you know, Flyers got to do what they got to do. And the culture thing's 100% right with everything this team has been going with the last regime. You can't. He's unfortunately tainted, and you have to move on.
Right. I mean, you need to also think about your team. Like, hey, going forward, if you put yourself in this situation, this is a possibility and you won't be here. You know what I mean? Like, I don't want to say it's unfortunate, because obviously if you do something wrong, if you break the law, you get what you deserve. But if I'm part of this regime, like Carter Hart, unfortunately, he's got to be the example. If you associate yourself with any of this stuff, innocent or not, we don't want people like that here. You know what I mean? And I say this knowing a little bit more than I'm giving up on the show. So if people want to tell me, hey, he's guilty in your eyes before he goes through court. Well, you know, things will play out how they're going to play out. I hope, like I said, I hope everything works out the best for everyone involved. I do want to read the statement real quick on behalf of Carter Hart, Jack, because if we can pick this apart a little bit, why not? So the statement was tweeted out from Savard Foy, LLP, at Savard Foy on X or Twitter, whatever you guys call it now. The statement reads, "We act for Carter Hart and confirm he has been charged with one count of sexual assault. He is innocent and will provide a full response to this false allegation in the proper forum, a court of law. Until then, we have no comment." And that's from Megan Savard and Riaz Sayani. So you're right. The language in there was a little stronger than some of the other guys. They made sure to say it was a false allegation. He is innocent and will provide the response to a false allegation. So, yeah, you read that and you're like, okay, maybe there's hope. But then it's like, well, the amount of time that this is going to take, there's not hope for him to play for the Flyers again. And that's kind of what I've been trying to get across for the last few weeks here. I mean, the situation is what it is. No one's going to touch him. No one's going to give anything of significance up for him. And I can see a world where the Flyers and Carter Hart just kind of go separate ways. Unless the NHL, I don't know what they can do, if they can freeze the contract or whatever, or he's going to get, I would assume, suspended after he's charged. After the charge, I assume he's going to get suspended. He is an RFA, so the Flyers hold his rights, but don't RFAs have to sign by a certain date, like the following season, Jack, before they become free agents? Is that how that works? Or am I thinking of something completely different?
Do you mean when they're a restricted free agent and they haven't signed in the offseason? It's right. Usually until December, I think. Yeah. It's around. I'm going by playing NHL standards, because I'll forget about somebody and they'll remind me. I'm almost positive you have till about December, and then they just become a free agent. I can't tell you the last time something like this happened. So I got to assume between the administrative leave and whatnot. And I just think everything's going to be termed. The contract's going to be terminated at some point, and he's going to be gone for so long, it's almost pointless.
Right.
I don't know if the Flyers will retain his rights. I don't know if it matters. I don't think it's going to matter. And just to piggyback something you said earlier, if there's any kind of Flyers organizational positive from this, Hart was a huge building piece to this building block piece to this rebuild. If it can happen to him, it can happen to anybody. So don't fuck around.
Yeah. I mean, that's gotta be the message. Don't put yourself in these situations. You know, you never know what's going to happen. I think how the story went, and you know, if you can correct me, or guys in the comments, if you know, I think how the story went. So these guys were all out, part of Hockey Canada. It was the World Juniors. They all went out to a bar. The main guy, who I think everybody can guess by now, because he was the only one not playing in the NHL, right? No team would touch him. Took a girl back, and for whatever reason, at least this is what's out there, decided to call his buddies back and say, "Hey, I got this girl. She's willing to do anything, yada yada," and they all come back. So in my eyes, player number one, the one that brought his buddies into this, huge scumbag, man. Like, scumbag's not even the word I want to use. Like, it's probably the one that you've been wanting to use for a couple of weeks. Like, because now you didn't just take yourself down. Now you took your buddies down. You know what I mean? Just being in that room, they're now associated with whatever happened. Okay. And that to me is a true piece of shit. Whether you're a kid or not, you know what's morally right and wrong. So I just wanted to get that out.
Yeah, I really do want to know who that player was. I just out of morbid curiosity. I really hope it's not Hart. I don't think it is, but you never know. I just want to point out real quick, thanks for pulling up. Ty Shelton said this, Dan Knightley, and this immediately reminds me a couple of years ago, maybe more than a couple of years ago now, this almost happened to Nylander. I remember Toronto, we right up until the last second, signed him before December 1st. And that's right, he would have sat out the season. I remember that now. Flyers were in on potentially trading Ghost and something else at the time. Man, I felt like a lifetime ago. But yeah, that's a correct answer to the question asked. So thank you for that.
Yeah, and good point here from where'd it go? He's scum, but they don't have to follow. That's right. Habs Insights checking in. Montreal fan. I wonder, have you seen our Reinbacher clip on YouTube? Is that how maybe you found us? Habs Insight. Thanks for checking in. We appreciate you hanging out. But yeah, it pretty clearly was Alex Fournette and now the main person in all of this. So yeah, thanks for pointing that out. But so yeah, I mean, the Flyers, I think, have done a decent job of preparing themselves for this day, Jack, right? Like, Sam Ersson's come up. He's gotten some starts. He's basically split the starts with Carter Hart since, I don't know, about 2 months ago. Carter Hart started popping up with an illness or whatever. He was eating bad fish. Yeah, thanks for letting us know. That's pretty cool. Yeah, Ersson's been getting in there a lot, and he's looked good up until this past week when the entire team kind of took a dive. And, you know, as we all know, they're heading into the All-Star break on a 5-game losing streak. We mentioned Kolesov. We mentioned Ersson's here. How about getting a guy like Cal Peterson back in a trade, Jack? Like, is he not the perfect, yeah, we'll take him, and if we need him to back up Ersson some point next year, he's the perfect guy. I know he's making $5 million, but he's an NHL goalie that you can send back and forth, right? Another hint that, hey, something might be up here. They go out and draft two goalies in the NHL draft. You know, high-pick goalies. I think they were both in the second round, no?
Second and third. I'm going to probably put that in your head because I kept saying that before. Yeah. But so it's second and third, yeah. But those are still high, you know, not first-round pick. But, yeah, I think you nailed it with Peterson. You can move it. You can't do that with Sandstrom or whoever else you want to, you know, Peterson goes up and down. If somebody claims him, that's gold for you. That's not happening. But he's a goalie with NHL experience. He's obviously has to a lot of making up to do for his career, but at least he's got some usefulness. He's not just rotten on your roster.
Yeah, totally agree. And he's only going to be here for another year. That's $5 million, I think, come off the books. And we'll see what ends up happening with Kolesov. I think he's good enough to be I would like to see him get his feet wet in the AHL. I always kind of like when guys get their feet wet first in pro hockey in America before they get called up to the NHL. We can work out any kinks and whatnot. Oakham's Razor mentions Zavrajan. He's dominating the league he's in now. He's not in the KHL yet. I think he's in the next tier down. I believe he just lost his first game of the year last week. And his goals against average is like under 2. So stud prospect coming up. You know, I think Mikey D always says it, always be drafting goalies, right? And that's the Flyers, they're doing.
Hey, you don't have to draft them all in the first and second round. Just every year, just, you know, grab a goalie. These guys take so long to develop. You never know when you can find a gem. And they're hell trade commodities if you need them. So absolutely, every year, at least get one.
Yeah, that's for sure. So great comments, guys, on the side. If you have any more Carter Hart points that maybe we missed that you guys want to bring up and discuss, feel free. In the meantime, there you go. Igor's 11-1 in the VHL. Thank you. And we will move on a bit here. So some good news last week, Jack. Owen Tippett signed a new deal. You want to talk about that?
First off, Danny Briere wasted no time in spending that Carter Hart money. Whether you want to talk about what he's currently making or what they were going to have to use to retain him in this offseason, Most of that just went to Owen Tippett, and I'm all for it. I know they're not the same players. I know they have their differences, but this is so reminiscent to me of when they signed TK. Jeez, this contract will be over next year. That's how long ago it was. I believe that was 5 for 5 for 6 years. This is 8 for 6.2. Like, I will take that. I mean, I do think today it's a slight overpay, but the idea of doing this is these players are going to develop into better players, and it becomes a bargain, much like it did with TK, much like it did. And we're seeing Owen Tippett just blossom before our eyes. He was good last year. He's been even better this year. He's showing parts of his games I didn't even know he had. And you heard Colby Cohen say last week how I didn't realize this. He's a coach's kid. You know, like, those guys, they know how to play every facet of the game. They were brought up that way. And you add natural skill to that as well. Like, what he can do for this team, whether it be a first, second line, power play, whatever, on top of what you got coming in 5 years, 6.2, with the way the cap's supposed to go and overall inflation of free agent contracts, it's going to look like nothing. It's not going to be bad at all. I have no issues with this deal whatsoever. Is 8 a long time? Yeah, it is. But I wish Konechny had 3 more years on his deal, not 1. So I'll say that too. I'm very happy with this deal.
Yeah. And it was time to do it too, because the Flyers started taking a dive right after he got hurt. I think he got hurt against the Avalanche. And I believe that was their first of 5 in a row, the loss against Colorado. So if you're the agent, you're like, hey, you know, you're offering 5.5 for Tippett, and look what you guys are doing without him. You know, you can't win a game to save your life. And it was time for the Flyers, I think, to get it done. You know, apparently the talks, they've been in talks for months and months. And earlier in the season, we were saying Flyers should sign Tippett now because he's not at his peak yet. He's, you know, he's not scoring goals. He's blah, yada, yada. Sign him while he's in the valley instead of when he's at his peak. All of a sudden, he's got 2 Spinorama highlight reel goals. Same week or a week later, gets a new 8-year deal worth $49.6 million. So he's a rich man. And, you know, he's going to be a good player for the Flyers for a long time. I'm excited. So there's an article that I do want to pump. I wanted to kind of pump it last week a little bit. So Victor Nuno of Elite Prospects put out an article about Owen Tippett last week. Maybe pumping it because I gave my thoughts in it. So go check it out on Elite Prospects. Nice little article on Owen Tippett. This is a guy that has potential for 40 goals, Jack. I mean, when's the last time we could say that about a player on the Flyers? I mean, who's the last guy to do it?
Jeff Carter.
That's a long time ago now. It doesn't seem that long, but that's a long time ago. Owen Tippett has legitimate 40 goal potential, and you know, he offensively, he's one of the most fun players to watch, especially of late. I mean, the guy, once he gets going, I mean, you saw it on the Spinorama goal, once he gets going full steam ahead, there's no stopping him. And you know, apparently has the skill to do what he did. So I'm happy they locked him up. You know, if Owen Tippett's a 25, a lock for 25 to 30 goals every year, that's about what this contract is paying for. If he can give you, you know, let's say at least 2 seasons of 40 goals, that's pretty good, you know?
And there's overall other facets to his game too. Like, it's not like you're purely paying for goal scoring. He's very, a lot of this credit to Torts, where a lot of people thought that those two would not mesh. He's got a lot more to his game. I'm not saying he's a defensive stalwart or anything like that, but he's not like you're just paying JVRing this and paying for just pure goals. And if you don't get him, it's a wasted deal. So JVR having a very good year, by the way. So I'm not slandering too much. But like, this is a young guy. Pay him now while you have the cap space. You know, that way in a couple of years when you're going for it, this contract's not going to look bad at all. Potentially a bargain. You have more money to add whoever you want down the line. Keep your guys. You know, I don't know how you could be too upset with this deal. It's reminiscent of what good teams do. Lock guys up early, lock them up long, and in 4 or 5 years, you save money.
Totally agree. You know what made this even more? You know what made me laugh? Because earlier in the season, in our group chat, and I don't think it was ever really that serious, but I had mentioned, this is when we still had Carter Gauthier. I wondered if Owen Tippett could potentially be you know, a guy that, you know, the Flyers might explore a trade. Obviously, after they moved Carter Gauthier, that all went out the window for me. Like, I think Tippett is probably what Gauthier is going to be at the NHL level. 50-60 point player consistently. Will score 30 goals or close to it pretty consistently, and he'll have the occasional 40-goal season.
And he's not an entitled bitch.
And he's not an entitled bitch. And he got him for Claude Giroux, you know? I see Vance comment here, so I'll bring that up real quick. So Ant comments here, he's scoring and not even a PP guy. Most of his goals have been even strength. Yeah, I mean, so this team's strength is on the rush, and that's what Tippett's really good at. Did you see Torts' face after he scored that goal a few weeks ago?
No.
I'm sorry. Yeah, Torts' face. So he just... He's
I was at
fun.
The game, so I couldn't see it.
that's right. Yeah. He's having fun on the bench, Torts. I mean, that was fun to see. It's been not
Does anybody have Torts' face with Farabee's failed Michigan? That I want to see.
So here's something, Jack. So I tweeted something that I don't think got nearly enough respect. Farabee attempted the Michigan, and Boston proceeded to onslaught them with four goals in like 4 minutes directly after that. Right? So Farabee attempts the Michigan.
Yeah.
And directly after, Boston scores four goals in like 4 minutes.
Oh.
I tweeted this out, you know, because I was just kind of joking. But at the same time, it's like, don't you think that's a team that's going to see that and be like, well, now we're going to do this to you, right?
In a sense, it's funny because I feel like coaches get more angry, not players on the ice, especially a team like Boston. I just think that part of that is just they're incredible. If you look at the teams the Flyers have lost to, the top players have taken over. You can add Pasta to that. You know, we already had McKinnon and Kucherov just dismantle the Flyers. But yeah, I do think that could set a team off, especially when if I'm Boston, I'm like, we're better than the Flyers. You know what I mean? So,
yeah.
And it, I mean, to me, if you fail it, you kind of look stupid, you know, but yeah, I guess anything can set a team off, especially if you're going to get cute with us here, we'll show you cute.
I mean, best team in the league and you're going to try the Michigan. I don't know if that was a smart move or not, but you know, it's maybe a conversation. So Dave brings this up, Jack, and I kind of laugh because you know what? It reminds me of our conversations with Morgan Frost and passing between the legs back to the blue line, yada, yada. It's like, I don't like fun. You know, but I like fun when it's at the appropriate time kind of thing. So I don't know.
you have a Torts mentality. Like if you're going to try it, you better do it. Because if it doesn't work, I'm going to roast your ass.
pretty much.
So I'm not that way now, but I'm going to be that way when they're in meaningful games. Like when it's like Miechkov's here and it's like, okay, we've waited all these years. The rebuild's over. We're going for it. When they start doing that stuff and failing and we're supposed to be winning games, that's when I'm going to act like you. Cause I can't help it. Cause you know, I'm going to get infuriated watching a game with me. I don't recommend for anybody. I'm very illogical. I need intermissions do a lot for me. I need to break down what I think I saw and calm myself down. But to your point, Jim, one of those things, I'm like, if you're going to try it, you better be successful. Cause if you don't, I'm going to roast your ass. I just can't help myself.
Yeah. I mean, it's time and place, you know, and that, for me, that goes for behind the back passes or behind between the legs passes and Michigan's. Anyways, there's some good comments here that I do want to touch on real quick, Jack. I'm kind of going to do them in backwards order. So the newer comments a little bit more relevant. So we have Deep Sky Bry. Deep Sky Bry comments, whatever happened to Matai Tomek, Kirill Ustamenko, Ivan Fedotov, or Fedotov, hopefully Ersan grows, molds into a legit starter. Great approach by DB in the 2023 draft and contingency plan. So those other goalies, Jack, I don't know too much about what happened to them. I'll let you touch on them, but I will say this. Did you see the clip of Tortorella, you know, patting Ersan in the chest the other night, telling it wasn't his fault, you know, that he's not pulling them because he gave up four goals or whatever?
Yep, absolutely. I know exactly. He slapped him in the chest. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Right. And in the media, Torts has sort of, I don't want to say favored, but he's talked pretty good when talking about Ersan. His face kind of lights up a little bit. He'll say nice things about Ersan. Now, maybe I just missed these times, but have you ever seen him talk about Hart like that, or, you know, talk glowingly about Carter Hart, or, you know, if Hart gives up four in a period, Does he pull him for the third period? Does he get in his face and say, hey, I'm not pulling you. This is why I'm pulling you. It's not your fault. I want to see them, you know, fight a little bit, play some defense. That was another tip off for me. I mean, do you buy into that a little bit?
I definitely noticed that he likes Arizona. It seems a lot more. I don't think he's ever thrown Hart under the bus. Yep. I have heard him say it's not on Hart before in post games, but I definitely see more. I don't want to say favoritism is the right word, but he definitely seems to be more endearing with Arizona. I'll say that because the guy's been great this year. And I think he carries himself very well, and he's going through maybe one of his first tough times as a pro. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot going on with the team too. So, you know, maybe he's getting a little down on himself. And I love that he was asked, like, well, what'd you say to him? And he's like, I'm not telling you, basically.
Yeah.
You know, but just to, the questions are being answered in the chat on the three goalies. Tomek is still with the organization in some way, shape or form. Ustamenko is not. Looks like he went back to the KHL. I know he had an injury, and then I'm pretty sure they released him after that. Fedotov, we talked about for a lot over the offseason with his never-ending saga. Still with the organization in some way, shape, or form. If we ever see him, we will throw a party, whether he makes the NHL or not, which he probably won't. But it'll just be nice to see him get over here.
Yeah, that's for sure. I think he's going to be over 30 by the time he gets here at this point. Just interesting stuff there. Great, great comments. Good questions, guys. But I will say this, listen to Tortorella with an open mind when he talks, because he won't throw a guy under the bus, but he just won't talk about him. When he likes a guy, he'll talk about him. When he doesn't, he just won't talk about him. And one of the things I noticed right away with Tortorella during his first training camp, so he kind of gave this away a little bit, at least to me. Somebody asked him a goalie question, and he said he hasn't even looked at goalies. He doesn't watch the goalies practice. He's not a goalie guy. That's why he's got the goalie coach, right? A couple weeks later, somebody brought up Sam Ersson. Couldn't speak more positively about him. And to me, that was, that's really interesting. All of a sudden, he's watching goalies. You know, he has all these good things to say about Ersson. He's calm. He plays big in goal. He's under control. You know, all these things, all of a sudden he's, and you know, I don't believe him when he says he doesn't watch goalies. Of course he does. He's just, you know, so I don't know. To me, that was a tell. Okay, all of a sudden we're watching goalies torts. When's the last time you said something that good about Carter Hart? You know what I mean? So just, pay attention, because he'll give hints to if he likes a guy or not. That's all.
Yeah, I mean, I do think the entire organization knew about some things with Hart here, even going back to when Torres was hired. Now, somebody asked, did Hextall know when he was drafted? When that would be 2016, Hart was drafted. I have no idea. I would like to not think so, but I can't say that it went that far back. However, everybody currently that was with the regime, and even before the regime, I'm sure knew something.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, like we mentioned earlier in the show, this is one of the worst kept secrets. Like, this day was coming. We knew it. There's a question from Linden 49, and it's a good question. This is the first time I think we've seen Linden 49 in here, so I want to make sure we get his question up. Thanks for hanging out. James, thanks for the info, but don't you think we should wait for due process to take place before we convict, or are you not telling us everything? Thank you. I'm assuming that's Tips. Tips signing was a good move. Yeah, I mean... You guys know everything we know, except for what we can't really say. I mean, you guys are going to find out soon enough. Like, you know enough at this point.
I think our ultimate point was, no matter what happens, he probably still can't come back to the Flyers. That was ultimately what we were saying. I mean,
he can
eventually get off. It's looking like it'll be in like 3 years, you know, at least. And the Flyers, they kind of are in a culture change where they just have to wash their hands of these things.
Right.
It would, not only can somebody have to be found, he'd have to be found completely innocent and not even be a bystander, which would be really good for him and just probably unlikely. I don't know, but considering they have a whole team and only these five guys are brought in, I can't see a scenario where, you know, Hart should not have been, you know, the other guys get prosecuted, but he doesn't. I just don't see that happening. I find it, even if he is acquitted or something of that nature, the Flyers have to look at this like, we are going through a massive culture change. We don't want anybody even in these situations or doing anything stupid like this, or, you know, making the right decisions when they see something like this happening. And it's better just to cut your losses and move on. They have other goaltenders in this system, and all they would be doing essentially, if they did bring it back, would, I don't even know, like giving him a shot and then trying to move him for some kind of pick or something. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense. So I mean, we're saying
they do that, they're opening themselves up to criticism and questions and distractions. You know what I mean? Like, it's just how many times they don't need to take on.
And how many times, in teams out of all sports, they'll sign a guy who's like risky, and then they're not sure how the media is going to react, and then they get destroyed. And it's only getting worse. It's only getting worse, and maybe rightfully so. So, you know, I'm trying to think of a good example of somebody, a team, Boston signed that one prospect. His name escapes me. I forget what he did exactly, but it was heinous. And I think they still have the guy. I'm not even sure. It wasn't even an NHL player. It was only a prospect, and they got absolutely destroyed for that signing. So they have to be very careful what they do. And Boston's not a team who needs a culture change. They have a winning culture up there. Flyers have a lot of changing they have to do. So it just doesn't make a lot of sense, unfortunately.
Yeah. And so there's some good, there's more comments here. I want to get to these. We'll see. If you guys want to move on, we can. You guys can dictate the show. Like I said, we have a show chock full of topics. I do want to address some of these comments here. So Jamie Cowie comments. Jamie, this is the first time we've seen you here. Hopefully you stick around. No room for gang rapists. Sick. But at least they videotaped their innocent actions. The victim isn't the Flames, Flyers, or Devils who employed while knowing allegations are there. The victim is the girl. And that's 100% correct. Could not agree with you more. I would ask maybe go back and listen to the beginning of our show. Because we do talk hockey, and we're trying to, you know, talk about the hockey perspective here. But obviously, first and foremost, the victim needs justice. And we 100% agree with you, Jamie. Thank you for hanging out. Another one, we have Rosie W. First time I've seen Rosie W in here. Hopefully we see more of you. Even if Hart wasn't involved. So I'm going to assume, Jack, that this means even if he was in the room. So this is my thought here. Even if he was in the room and knew what was going on, and this is assuming the worst, right? Like, let's say they knew what was happening and this really was, you know, gang rape kind of thing. And he knew that was going on. Like, how can you be in the same room, Jack, and not know that that's happening, right? There's conversation. Like, you know, like, even if you're a kid, 17, 18, 19, you know, like I said, you morally know the difference between what's right and what's wrong. And it's not enough, in my opinion, to just remove yourself from the situation, right? It's something wrong is happening here. And if they chose not to do anything, they're a part of it. That's how it works, right? And did you hear Carter Hart come out and say, hey, something not good happened here. We need to help this person. No, we didn't. So, you know, the whole innocent until proven guilty thing, in my head, in this situation, okay, you didn't actually have to participate, but you knew what was going down in that room and chose to do nothing. So, you know, there's a saying that the people who choose to do nothing are the worst men, because they know the difference between right and wrong, and they don't act. They allow the bad to happen. So, you know, you got to do the right thing, man. It's tough sometimes, but it's a test of your character. And sometimes, man, if something like that's happening right in front of your eyes, as hard as it is to, you know, rat on your buddies, whatever it is, you need to do the right thing. And unfortunately, he was put in that situation and potentially made the wrong choice, right? I say potentially because I don't want to piss anybody off. I know it has to play out, and he needs to be convicted in a court of law. So great questions, great responses from Jamie and Rosie there. Thanks, guys, for checking in. Jack, you actually brought this topic up earlier today. How about a Hobey Baker candidate Massimo Rizzo. Will he win it? Will he sign with the Flyers? What do you think?
I mean, he better sign with the Flyers. I've had enough of players not signing with the Flyers. Players are titled bastards. But not, I mean, Jim, the one of the candidates is your boy who's going to be potentially going top 10 in the draft this year, too. It's like, can we have an embarrassment of riches? No, we're probably too far out for that. But to see Rizzo in there, who was a Tony DeAngelo deal, if I'm correct, or it was funny how that deal went down, but that needless to say, that's what it was. Talk about rags to riches. We all thought we were just getting a contract. I mean, my God. Oh, geez. And all your countrymen are coming out for you now.
And comments, loud Italian noises, and Slaypool is a mainstay on the show. Slaypool, thanks for hanging out. I voted for the Riz King for Hobie Baker. And yeah, I think he still leads the NCAA in points. He did as of, what's today, Jack? Tuesday? He did as of Friday or Saturday. So I don't think he was overtaken. So yeah, I mean, that's pretty cool to see. You got Booyam, Rizzo, and I think Jack Devine was on there as well. He plays on the same line as Massimo Rizzo, but yeah, man, a former seventh round pick that, you know, nobody was really expecting anything. And, you know, I just want to remind that he is 22 years old, still playing in the NCAA. Nothing wrong with that. He's a junior, making the most of his situation, which I don't think you can hold his age against him. You know, like he's producing, you know? So, Oakham mentions here that Devine has more goals. Flyers need center. So here's what I want to say about Rizzo, because he's having a hell of a season. Excuse me. He may be one of those tweener guys. You know, the Flyers need center depth across the entire organization in the AHL as well. Like, look at their AHL. They're pretty barren for centers. So he could be the guy that will stick around on the top six in the AHL and be a call-up for the Flyers if they need, I don't know, a third-line guy, something like that. Because you watch him, and there are times where he looks a little sluggish. And once his team gets the puck, I mean, he kind of turns it on. I haven't watched them in a couple months now. But, you know, at first I was like, hey, what is it about this guy? How's he putting up points? He's scoring a lot of points against, you know, kind of cupcake teams and whatnot. But he kind of turned it on as the season got going. And, you know, you don't really lead the NCAA in scoring by accident. So there's something there. And, Jack, obviously, this is a guy that I can't wait to talk about. Mm-hmm. Riz's teammate, Ziv Booyam, would look sweet in orange and black. And would. Right-handed shot, freshman. He just turned 18 back in December. This kid, in my opinion, coach's dream. And I don't want to talk about him too much because the draft is obviously, I don't know, what is it, 7 or 5, 6 months away now. But Ziv Booyam, guys, you could see right away, this kid has it. He does all the little things, in my opinion, correct. He doesn't make too many mistakes. Or when he does make a mistake, it's not very often. And it's impressive because he's so young. He does it all. He does everything. I think he had 2 shots on goal during the World Junior Classic, Jack, and they were both goals. You know, just a really good player, and he's going to be available in the 2024 NHL draft. And hey, the Flyers keep this losing stuff up. He could be back on the menu, Ziv Booyam.
I mean, that was kind of what we could allude to before we go to potential trade deadline stuff. There was one more signing, and that would be Ryan Poehling to a 2-year deal at 1.9. And the big question surrounding that, whether or not you like it, is does this spell the end of Scotty Laughton, who still has 2 more years at 3 mil, I believe?
Yeah, that's correct. I don't know. That's a tough question. I think at face value, it looks like, okay, they just replaced Scotty Laughton. But is that this year? I mean, I guess it depends on what a trade looks like for Laughton. Like what would you accept? What's the lowest you would accept for Laughton? Because we know we'd all want the first, but what's the lowest you would accept for Scott Laughton at the trade deadline this year? With the year on his deal, he's, you know, he's worth a little bit.
That's a good question. I mean, probably a second, a conditional second, something like that. I don't think it's worth trading a third because what he brings to the locker room. I know he's having a down year. There were rumors of a first. I also heard that wasn't necessarily true. However, I would like to hold out for something as close to that as possible. You have him for $3 million is nothing for a player like that. I've seen a lot of teams who want to add that kind of heart, that kind of utility to their offense. And that it, you can get that screams Scotty Laughton, not to mention manageable. Now, I think the only thing is he's got two more years attached to it. That could be a good thing. That could be a bad thing. I lean to think it's a good thing because that is very manageable to fit in your lineup. And it's a great heart player, a guy you can play all over, everything we've said. I've already heard that Dallas has been rumored to be interested in a player of that nature. So take that for what you will, but it's still January. I know it's the last day of January, but like, we're not even there yet. And I'm, you know, obviously the number one guy's got to go is Walker. Got to get that first baby. But if they do decide to move on from Laughton, it shouldn't be for the sake of moving on from it. It should be a second has to be involved in some way, shape, or form. Other than that, I feel like you're just trading him for the sake of trading him. And that doesn't make sense for your locker room.
That's at least for Laughton, you mean, right?
At least. Or was that second, Walker? I want the first for Walker. This is what I heard. And this is not personal. It's just me reading the internet. Heard that some people think first is a stretch, where other allegedly GMs think that first is a pretty fair offer. And a lot of that has to do with his contract. It's a rental, but who can't fit $2 million plus into their lineup? Was he $2.5 million? I can't remember. And there's a lot of, it's a premium position. It's a right-handed defenseman. Like, who doesn't need that?
Hopefully a team like Tampa Bay comes calling this way, you know, because they get a little crazy at the deadline, right?
I heard Tampa. I heard Edmonton. And there's one more team. Maybe I don't think it was Toronto, but I don't want to speculate too much. But it makes too much sense. There's like Edmonton makes sense because they have cap issues. Like getting a guy in for that cheap who can fill a role that they need, that makes sense. Tampa does get crazy. You know what they gave up for Braden Coburn? Should I remind you? They gave up a first, a third, and Ratko Gudas. I mean, and that first that they gave up was packaged in the deal to get Konechny. So, hey, I'm all for it. We got to get 4 first-round picks in this year's draft. We have 2. Walker should get us a third and somehow figure out to get the other one.
So here's a recent trade, too, for Tampa. So it apparently hasn't stopped with them. Like, it's still madness down there. You remember Tanner Jeannot, Jack? He used to play for the Nashville Predators.
Yeah.
The Tampa Bay Lightning gave up a 2023 third round pick, 2023 fourth round pick, 2023 fifth round pick, 2024 second round pick, and a 2025 first round pick for Tanner Jeannot, Jack. And I'm not sure what they were thinking. Maybe they thought they were getting another Brandon Hagel type guy. They signed him to a 2-year deal, so obviously not 2.6 per. But my point is, they gave up 6 draft picks for Tanner Jeannot. Like, okay, maybe third, fourth, fifth round picks, they can toss them away because they have Kucherov, Stamkos, Point, Hedman, Vasilevsky, and they're going for it, right? Sure. But if you're a team like the Flyers, yeah, you'll take those picks all day long. That's ammunition. Like, I don't care if they trade fourth and fifth round picks personally. Use your first, seconds, and thirds, trade your fourth, fifths, yada, yada, in deals like this when you need them. But, I'm on the phone with Tampa Bay now. Like, okay, yeah, we'll take that for Scott Walker. What can you add? Okay, yeah, we'll take that for Sean Walker. What can you add? You know? So,
look, man,
glad people they're one of the teams.
People get goofy at the trade deadline. I don't know what year it was. I think it was 2019 or something like that. Golden Knights traded a first, second, and third to Detroit for Thomas Tatar. What? Yeah. Like, that kind of Flyers gave up a first and a third for Christopher Stieg. Like, I mean, it gets goofy, man. And you're telling me you're not going to take a fly. You can re-sign Walker, too. It's not that that ridiculous. So you can still trade for him. And if you can make it work, sign him. A first for a right-handed defenseman who's playing wonderfully this year. That's too much. And it's easy to fit into your cap. You don't have to play games and whatnot. It's not that crazy. It's not that crazy at all. Stanley Steamer.
Yeah. Is that Newman?
No. That's Stanley. That's Stan the man.
His name's actually Stanley.
Roebling too.
All right. Yeah. So it is going to be an interesting trade deadline, and you know it sucks to say, but you know, this 5-game skid, I think probably came at a really good time for 2 reasons. The Flyers can take some time off, recoup. You know, that like mentally and physically, they have to be you know, feeling it right now. Physically, yeah, they're playing every other night. Mentally, you lost Owen Tippett to injury, and you lost your, you know, a guy that everyone thought was the franchise goalie here. Like, that's a massive blow to a locker room, you know? They go on the five-game losing streak. All right, they need the break. The flip side of that is, if I mean, you heard management, you heard Briere, you heard Torts, they're still sticking to the plan. If you guys listen to PHLY, I think it's Flyers, forgive me, but it's Charlie and Bill's show. They had Keith Jones on a couple weeks ago. It was a really good interview. It was 20 minutes long. I recommend everybody go watch it. Shout out, tell them I sent you. But Jones, he said it. It was going to be tough. This was before the five-game losing streak. They're going to try to thread the needle at the deadline, where they're going to try to make the playoffs and still sell off, it sounded like, the players that made sense. My take is, a five-game losing streak, you're getting pounded by teams with premier talent, Colorado, Boston. Who's the other one they lost to, Jack? They're escaping me now. Oh, Tampa Bay.
Yeah,
I mean, Pasternak, McKinnon, Kucherov all went off against you. You can play with these teams. I'm pretty sure they outshot them all. But the premier players on other teams showed up against the Flyers. Flyers don't necessarily have those guys. I think it was kind of a jolt, like, hey, this is reality here. You know, we are good enough to make the playoffs, but we are not good enough to beat these teams. And that's what we aspire to be. So I'm hoping that, you know, these ass kickings, or they look like ass kickings on the score sheet, kind of help the front office maybe made it a little easier. Okay, you know, we're close to playoffs, but that's not the goal. The goal is to compete for a Stanley Cup year in and year out. And you need premier talent. And I'm hoping, you know, and you know better than anyone, Jack. You've been saying it for years. The way to get premier talent, draft picks. In today's NHL, it's draft picks. So a guy like Sean Walker, if you can get a first-round pick for Sean Walker, you do it. It doesn't matter how late the pick is, right? It's just you take the first because it's yours now. You could package it with another first, move up, go get a center that you desperately need in the top six. So you collect as many picks as you can, right?
And the other thing is, if in the offseason, if you told me when they got Sean Walker, like, yeah, maybe you can flip him for a fourth at the trade deadline, I'd have said, nice, another asset in the Provorov deal. The idea of getting a first or a second plus, come on. And now that you have Drysdale, there's no reason not to trade him. They're talking to bringing Nick Seeler back now. Nothing official, obviously. That seems to be what they're going to keep. But Walker, I mean, come on, this is an easy one. Play these teams against each other, get a bidding war, get a first round pick, and let's go. I mean, as far as who else they could trade off, I don't think anybody's taking Atkinson. So, like, who else jumps out at you? I mean, it would have been Seeler, but they sound like they're going to bring him back. Walker makes too much sense to move. Everybody else is pretty young. You know, I don't think you're getting anything for Risto. There's too much length on that contract and money. I think he could be a solid third line, third pairing defenseman who occasionally plays on the second pairing. But at, what's it, 3-4 more years at 5.1 or 2? Come on. Nobody's doing that. Not in this landscape. So I think you're stuck with him. So, yeah. I mean, they definitely have to. And, oh, I mean, maybe you can move Hathaway. He's got another year on his deal. I don't know. I don't think they're going to – they may dangle Laughton, but they're not going to trade him for the sake of trading him. Nobody else strikes me as a has-to-go kind of guy besides Walker. So if they trade him, then, you know, I take it. And then maybe something can happen in the offseason where you can make a larger deal for something else. But that's successful right there. And Keith Jones isn't going to come out and say, well, now that, you know, we're going to sink back down to earth and try to get a higher draft pick at this point in the season. They're going to trade assets. They're going to do what's right for the rebuild, and they're going to let the players play is essentially all we're being told.
Yep. Yeah. The players are going to dictate how extreme. And you're right. They don't, after Walker, it gets a little fuzzy. Like, Walker is the obvious choice to move, right? He was a guy you got to toss in a deal. All of a sudden, teams want him at the deadline. You take it. You take whatever they're offering. And we'll see what happens. We have the trade deadline's not as far off as it used to be, Jack. What are we, just a little bit over a month yet? When is it, in March?
it's like March like 8th or something. Like it's a 5 weeks away, something like that.
Yeah, by the time the season starts again, it'd be about a month till trade deadline. So I mean, these conversations are they're relevant. You know, decisions are going to have to be made. I'm wondering if we see a move during the break, you know, while things are kind of calmed down. I thought it was interesting. The Carter Hart news, well, the leave of absence news came out, Jack, and the same day or the very next day, all of a sudden the Flyers are spending money on Tippett, $6.2 million a year, Poehling, $1.9 million a year. I mean, that's $8 million right there. So if we were speculating that Hart was going to get eight on his re-sign, there's Hart's money. There's his re-sign money right there in those two players. They didn't waste any time. I would not be surprised if we did see a move now. I think it would behoove the Flyers to get something done if teams are offering what they want to pull the trigger. I don't think you play with fire and get greedy. The team's offering you, somebody put in here a first and a third, I think Oakham. If somebody offers you a first and third now for Walker, you slam the accept button.
Absolutely. You know? And I don't look back.
So, yeah, good conversation there.
I think a part of what we're waiting for is the other defenseman. I think it's Tanev in Calgary. If you look at the available defenseman on the trade deadline, Tanev is first, and I think Walker might be second. That's not exactly a long list of available defensemen, unless we're high enough on that list where he could demand a decent price for sure. And I want to see him go, Tanev, and I want to see what he gets, but I hope there's a first involved. I don't know all the details about the player and his contract and whatnot, but once that domino falls and it's all Walker, you know, pray he doesn't get hurt. You know, actually Lyndon brings up a good point that maybe this is more of an offseason thing. We have heard rumors about Frost. It sounds like they are trying to move him. And I won't say I hate what I've seen from Frost this year. I think you can definitely give him another year, but if they're hell bent on moving him, he should bring back an interesting return. I can't pinpoint exactly what it would be. Frost trade. And it seems more off season for me. Seems like a player for player deal, like a true hockey deal. I just don't know who that player is. Like Pinto made some sense back when we first heard it, and that couldn't gain any steam because of the gambling and whatnot. And then Frost sat out, you know, the first quarter of the season. So I don't know. I don't know where they sit with that, but he's definitely has some interest and he definitely has some value. So that's an interesting one to keep your eye on. Maybe get a draft day trade, Jim, trade up and get your boy.
Yeah, that'd be fun. Yeah. It was rumored that they could have been potentially kicking the tires on Arbor Zhekai. I think I said his last name right. His nickname's Wi-Fi because his last name is like a Wi-Fi password. but I haven't watched any of that kid. I know he's been in the AHL all year. I know the Canadians like him, and obviously it sounds like the Flyers like him. Now, I'll say this, because up until the torts conversation with Frost, I haven't been impressed with Frost. Like there have been glimpses of, okay, yeah, he's doing that again. You see sparks. And then there'll be other times where it's like, well, this is what pisses me off about Hart. Frost. All of January, he's been a different player and noticeably different. And I think that's been at least my number one complaint about Morgan Frost. He was one of those guys where you watch a game and you're like, is Frost playing tonight? Right? And now he's more times than not, Jack, the most noticeable player on the ice when he's out there for the Flyers. Anyways, there's, I don't know if it was like a switch that went off or what, but he's not hesitating anymore. He's not so much in his head. He's, if you think hockey's a sport where if you start thinking, you're already behind. You need to react, right? It's all muscle memory type stuff.
It's the instinct, baby.
Right. And you can tell when a guy's thinking, because that's all it takes is that split second. And like Provorov was a guy where it was like, he's thinking that's why he's getting beat. He's losing pucks. Frost was kind of like that. Another example is Igor Zamula. You can see when he's thinking. Number one, he's slow as molasses, but anyways, this is not an Igor Zamula conversation. He's been playing well. Morgan Frost, you can see Now you can see the second line center potential, in my opinion. And it wouldn't be so easy for me to move him unless they were really getting, and I know it's going to kind of be contradictory because why should they get a sure thing player in return for a guy like Frost? But unless they're thinking he just needs a change of scenery and, you know, we'll take a guy like Owen Tippett in return where, you know, the change of scenery is for him here and we can work with them, I'm not sure that I would be so quick to move Frost. I've really enjoyed the way he's played. Sans the behind the between the legs, behind the back passes to the blue line on the power play. But everything else has been, I've been impressed. He's been quick. He's playing defensive hockey, turning pucks over in the offensive zone and extending shifts for his line. I've enjoyed watching Morgan Frost play hockey for probably all of January. So I'm not sure that I would be on that trade bus.
And it's funny is I don't necessarily disagree. And the Flyers have a lack at center that the brass seems to have already be until they trade him. I can't say for sure, but it just seems like they in their minds have already moved on from him and are just exploring trade options. I thought I read that Briere does somewhat like him, but I mean, we can't, who knows? I can't say Torts does or doesn't. He seems like a fair enough guy. He just is the way he is. But if there's too many rumors about moving on from Frost. So, I mean, it's intriguing. You have people, and I don't necessarily disagree with either side because we've seen all facets of Frost. We don't know what's real, what's not. People think he's no better than the third line center is in the chat, but he does have youth. So it's like, can you get something for that? Maybe, maybe not. Other people think it's too valuable to trade, mostly because we need centers, but maybe there's still potential there that needs to be unlocked, and it's just a matter of putting it together. So we'll see.
So there's your Frost as a third line center. He won't bring back much comment. I got distracted for a second. There was another comment here. So the brass is high on Hunter McDonald, Jack. We haven't heard much of anything about him. I don't even remember now if it was this past development camp or.
I think it was. And then Keith Jones said something about him recently. It might have been on the same interview that you were referring to. Mm-hmm. And that reminded me of him. I was kind of like, where did I hear this name before? And it was this past development camp. And I'm like, where did he come from? And was he a seventh round pick, sixth round pick, something like that?
Yeah, I think let me just make sure because he may have even been undrafted. Let me just double check.
That'd be even better.
Hang on here. Hunter McDonald, right? Yeah. Hang on, boys and girls. Go ahead, Jack. Take it away.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know a whole lot about the guy. I just remember him being brought up by the brass.
You're right. Sixth-round pick. Sorry.
2023 or two?
2022, yep.
2022. Yeah, I just remember being brought up in development camp and then recently again. And something about the way he plays, and I think he's a big kid and carries himself there. Happy with that. Great. If you imagine hitting on a defenseman in the sixth round, hey, my God. But yeah. You know what? Just keep adding to the cupboard. I'm all for it.
House money, man. You hit on a sixth round defenseman, even if you just bottom pair guy. He's 6'4", 207 on HockeyDB. Just has only played 10 games for Northeastern University this year, 2 assists, plus 4. Played 35 games last year, 14 points, 1 goal, plus 21 on the season. I have not watched a second of Hunter McDonald aside from the two prospect games against the New York, which I think he played in.
I'll be honest with you. I think we're a little worried about a defenseman, the last name McDonald. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I mean, we've been hurt in the past. He can't wear 47, you know, but maybe, you know, what goes around comes around. So we'll see. I mean, like I said, let him develop, let him cook.
Yeah, let's see what happens. There you go. Slaypool chiming in. Hunter was injured, and I think he just came back. Yeah, certainly looks like that. Jack, we're an hour and 10 minutes in. I'm having fun here. I feel like there was more we wanted to touch on. Was there anything else you wanted to discuss tonight? We have a lot of people hanging out, especially in the chat. I don't just want to end it if you guys want to hang out a little bit longer. So what else we got?
I'm podcasting again in 45 minutes, so you might as well keep going.
That's we can wrap up. I forgot all.
I'm saying we should just keep going. I guess.
Continue the conversation. Yeah.
So the two questions I had on here, and I actually do want to kind of get your thoughts on a question in the chat. It's kind of hard to answer because we don't know what the positions are exactly, But Ted E asked, would you trade Frost and the Florida first to move up in the draft? If the Flyers are going to, see, it's hard to give up a center with very little center depth. I would hope they'd have a backup plan for doing something in the short future. But if, I don't know where that pick's going to be. Florida's pretty good. So let's say it's like 27. Is that fair? 26, 27. How far up the draft do you think you can get for Frost and a 26th pick? If it gets you into a range to draft your boy, like that, which could be top 10, like 10, I don't think it does. I think it gets you 10, 12 positions up, which is just out of that reach. Still something to consider. Jim, I don't know. I would want to see more of the prospects. It'd be something I do closer to the actual draft where things start to settle out. Is that off the top of your head, though? Is that something you entertain, or even if your guy is not attainable?
So I'll say this. If I'm moving Frost, I think you need to have a plan to bring in a center somewhere. And if the plan is to package a first and Frost to move up and take a center, let's say in this year's draft, the only center right now that I think is worth the first and Frost is Macklin Celebrini. Not a deep draft for centers. It's a good draft for, you know, third line guys, potential second round guys, potential, I said, not guaranteed. So, you know, you have a potential second line guy already in Frost under contract for another year. I don't know. If it's moving up to take Zeev, I think you have to strongly consider that. But if the plan is to move up and take a center in this year's draft with Frost in the first, I'm not sure that there's a guy worth trading that for yet.
It's a move that you have to do when your guy's on the clock and you want to go get him. And it's got to, like you said, it's got to be defenseman, and they got to have a plan at center because they don't have much at center. So it's tough. Hopefully there's some other big deal in the offseason, or they bring somebody. I don't know who's even, I haven't looked yet, but just for on its face value, would I do something like that? I would do whatever I had to do for the right player. It's a little tough to say that with draft picks, but we do like our guys. It is what it is. And Celebrini's going to go one, so that's out. So, I mean, it's really for a defenseman at that point.
Really strong draft for D.
And on top of that, like, I like Drysdale. I like him a lot. I don't know if he's a number one, a true number one defenseman. I think he's part of this future, but I don't think he's true number one. And you still have to address that need. If you have an opportunity to, maybe something to consider. So we'll see.
It sure is. I like that Zach O is in my brain over here. I don't think moving Frost would be worth it unless you can get Celebrini. We have center depth as it is. Two minds thinking the same thing. How about that? Smart viewers and listeners, Jack. This is why you guys are the best. I've seen this name come up a lot. Anton Lundell.
Same.
I have no idea what they would want, but it is a name that I would kind of flirt around with and kick the tires on.
Well, I know he had a really good start to his career, but hasn't Florida learned their lesson by trading young guys to the Flyers?
Who was the last one? I don't remember.
Tippett.
Oh, that's right. Jeez. I mean, went on vacation down there for a couple months.
I would definitely be interested. I'd do a little more research on his, you know, more recent play. If he's just a guy who's not finding the ice time because the, you know, who they have down there has got like 30 something goals now. It slipped my mind. He came from Buffalo.
I'm sorry. Are you talking about Florida?
Yeah, Barkov's like feeding the puck all day long.
Reinhardt.
He's got like 33 goals or something crazy. Like,
summer.
There you go. Oh, that sucks for Florida. But like, if you got a guy like their top guys are doing it, the bottom pair guys, much like Tippett, aren't getting the ice time and whatnot. If you can get him for cheap, I'm on. You know, go all out by all means. But I don't see it happening. I think they'll wait it out this time.
How about this one? I think Zach's kind of joking around here. Frost and Farabee for Celebrini would effectively be Shen for Celebrini. You do that, Jack?
Oh, yeah. For Celebrini?
Yes, no.
Yeah.
So Celebrini is for sure a top-line center. Superstar, we'll see. Definitely. I mean, obviously.
He's a center. Number one. Let's go.
Yeah. That's a good point. Yeah. That's actually interesting. For as much as maybe Jack was joking, or I'm sorry, Zach was joking, that would... I don't know. That would be interesting.
They are young, but I don't know. I can't see a team doing that.
We'll roll down some comments here, Jack. Someone get Jim a cheesesteak. Yeah, I could use one. That's all I've been thinking about.
Are you allowed to have a cheesesteak?
Oh yeah, I can eat a cheesesteak, eh?
Okay.
Like I can eat all the junk. It's the healthy stuff that I can't eat. As whacked out as that is.
That is just cute. Just bullshit.
Yeah, weird. Mitchell saw someone say Duclair from the Sharks. Don't hate it. I guess if the Flyers are trying to add for maybe some kind of a half-assed run at the playoffs, I don't think they have a need for Duclair myself. What do you think, Jack? This is from Mitchell, by the way. Mitchell, thanks for checking in.
I think the Sharks will sell Duclair to the highest bidder of like real, you know, playoff teams that are really going for it. And yeah, I mean, if something happens and it's a JVR situation where teams just go elsewhere and he's sitting there, you want to throw him a really low pick, I guess, but I don't see the brass doing that.
No. I think I would agree. I mean, it'd give us a lot to talk about. I would be excited for Celebrini. I kind of really like Farabee, and I want to kind of see how his career unfolds, but we'll see. Teddy, half of the comment is caps. With the season in the tank, Hart news, I'm back to tanking. How about you guys?
I never left. I enjoy the ride because when the games are on, I can't help myself. But I know the assignment when the season started, and I'm still sticking to it.
If the Flyers are smart, they are in the perfect situation. There is never going to be another, I mean, we'll see. There's never going to be another season where fans are they don't necessarily have expectations, right? Because once you get a taste of a team being good, you go into the next season with expectations, right? And that's when you start getting your heart broken kind of thing. Because it's like, oh, they should be good by now, and they're not. They're losing to these teams still. This year, you know, if they lose 7-4 to the Avalanche, or if they put up a stinker against Ottawa and they lose 5 straight, it's kind of like, meh, oh, well. They'll just lose a bunch of games. You know what I mean? You can enjoy Flyers games this year, whether they win or lose. Yes. You can feel yourself getting sucked in a little bit, but when they bring you back down to earth, you're like, meh, this was supposed to happen, I think.
I'm telling you, I can watch games this year and be like, oh, shucks, where when it matters, I'm insufferable. Like, it's unfortunate, but I am.
Right. That's how it should be. We want to care. That's the whole point of being a fan. You want to care about what the team does. Jonathan Nesbitt, we've seen you in here before. Lundell seems more like a defensive forward. I don't know if the offensive upside is good enough to be a 2C. And at this point, I'm wondering if the problem is the Florida Panthers with potentially developing. Maybe they are a team where the Flyers look and go, this is a team that has reclamation projects. We should be, you know, trying to buy for pennies on the dollar here. Can we bring in a guy like Lundell, transform his game, see what happens? Yeah, I wouldn't hate to see them kick the tires. I haven't heard the name come up anywhere other than Twitter or the chat here. Jack, have you seen Lundell's name crop up anywhere?
No, like you said, just Twitter, you know, casual conversations. That's it. Nothing like legit.
Yeah, I'm a guy that I would like to see them kick tires on. Absolutely. And so let's say this is our last comment for the show here. This way you can take a break before you pop on with the boys tonight. We'll let you pump that in a sec. Slaypool, both of our London Knight boys got goals tonight. And he's talking about Denver Barkey and Oliver Bonk, who unbeknownst to me is called Bumper Bonk intentionally, Jack, not just because it sounds funny. He actually plays the bumper on the power play. So admittedly, I haven't watched Oliver Bonk all season until over the weekend. And, you know, I'll be putting out some prospect stuff for Dobber prospects later this week. But I'll be watching those two guys, Barkey and Bonk. Plays the bumper, Jack, and does a decent job playing it. I do want to say, when you see these guys putting up these huge numbers, please keep in mind that London is absolutely stacked. Mm-hmm. Like, they're beating teams like 10-0. You know what I mean? So I'm not going to sit here and say that Barkey and Bonk's stats are inflated because I haven't watched them, but that's what I'll be looking for. Okay, when are they scoring these goals? Are they scoring them early in the game when it matters? You know, are they scoring 4 and 5 points at a time in these 10-0 games? I don't want to call it a conversation, but a slight back and forth with our buddy Dan Silver earlier today, compared Barkey stats and Braden Point stats. And I made a point to say, hey, well, make sure you mention that one played in the WHL a few years back, obviously, and one's playing in the OHL today. And I think for whatever reason, either Dan didn't want to understand what I meant, or he maybe took it like, I'm not sure how he took it, but he got a little defensive, I thought. And my whole point was, Denver Barkey's not Braden Point. In short, Denver Barkey's a tenacious player. He's 5'9". He's playing center, I believe, still for London. Saw him in development camp. I saw him in the two games against the Rangers. He stood out. I mentioned he's tenacious, 5'9". He's got a little dog in him. And he reminded me of TK a little bit, watching him. And a TK light, right? I don't want to say TK right off the bat. And then boom. Oakham's razor right here. Barkey's a right wing, Point's a center. Call me when Denver Barkey puts up 40 goals in the NHL.
I think he was. Drop. It was said that as Dre when he was drafted. He was a light TK.
Barkey or Point?
Yeah, Barkey.
Yeah, there you go.
Or Barkley.
And that's who he kind of looks like when you watch him. He's got a motor on him, man. It never stops. So in Point's draft year, which was 2014. He scored 36 goals for 91 points in the WHL, scored 38 goals the year after, 87 points for the Moose Jaw Warriors. And real quick, Denver Barkey, I'll tell you what he scored in his draft year. So he was drafted in, obviously, 2023, scored 22 goals and 59 points, which is good. You know, he's already eclipsed that total this year in 20 less games. So, you know, they could have something here, but another win. Won't play center in the NHL. Don't think he'll ever score 40 goals in the NHL. Not sure what the point of comping them was. That's all. That was my only question, you know? So
somebody comps and Jim just rages.
Well, it's like, what are we doing here? Because now all of a sudden, don't get me going. Anyone that reads that is going to go, oh, so we have a potential Braden Point in the system. We don't. We don't. I don't understand.
Is Dan going to have to come on here and suck
it
to you?
Dan knows I love him. No, he knows. Oh, jeez. I just didn't get it. But anyways, all right. We should wrap this up here. You'll be back on with the boys. You want to pump that show real quick?
I do, because one, they did a great job. But also, we were discussing the matter earlier, and they did a great job on their inaugural show, which is called Midnight Misconduct, Burning the Midnight Oil. I think it came on at 10, but needless to say. They had Eric, and I apologize for butchering the last name here. Macaramala, you can?
Yeah, you got it. Well,
I got it. Hey,
yeah, congrats.
What I liked about it is they talked more about the legalities of the stuff that Jim and I weren't, you know, able to discuss. Just from we're not, you know, college law degrees or anything like that. Eric really broke a lot of the good stuff down. They asked a lot of good questions, good conversation. If you want more information on legalities of the Hart and the World Juniors case and all that, it's a great listen to. It's on our right on our YouTube channel and whatnot. And while you're there, check out Behind the Stripes. It's not often you get to get great reviews from a former referee on just current plays. And there was plays I didn't even realize happened that I was very interested to see what he would say. And I learned that a linesman, and call me stupid, I'm sorry, I don't pay attention to this stuff, but a linesman can't call any penalties. Yes, I knew that, but they can tell the official to call a major penalties only. So if they see something, yeah, I had no idea. I thought the guys with the orange band had to see it. So just little things like that. If you didn't know, breaking down a plays, whatnot, to just gold. So check it out if you get a chance, and check out the show tonight, Midnight Oil, or yours truly will be stopping by.
How about that? Great stuff by everybody involved. I think Dave was putting a lot of that together. He works hard. Make sure you guys check out his cheesesteak company, Delco Dave's Cheesesteaks. I think that's out in
Lincoln, Nebraska.
Yes, yeah. If you guys are ever out there, stop by Delco Dave's Steaks. He makes a good cheesesteak, the best cheesesteak in Nebraska, if I might say so myself. All right, Jack, let's put a bow on this. There was a lot of people in the comments, so I don't know if I'm going to go through individually here. We'll be here for another hour. So I want to thank everyone that hung out. We always appreciate the banter, the questions, the comments. You guys make this show fun. And yeah, we'll wrap this up. Flyers, what do we got? The All-Star game this weekend. I might actually go to that, Jack. I might. I
go
might.
In
I
person.
Might go to the All-Star game. Yeah, we got approved for me. Oh. So I might take the experience. We'll see. You know, it's already cold down here, and it's going to be worse up there. So I don't know if we'll see. I'll keep you guys in the loop, and maybe we'll do a show while I'm up there or something. But so yeah, we'll one last time. Give us a subscribe, follow. I think we had a lot of new viewers and listeners on this show. So make sure, please, you hit subscribe and set an alert for future shows. Listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or YouTube. And once again, set alerts for weekly shows. Make sure to favorite HOO.BE/HW Hockey or head over to HWHockey.net for all of our latest episodes and articles. And as always, thank you for hanging out. Everybody have a good night, and we'll talk to you soon.
Booyah.